talk to you about kind of the what of our mission, kind of the nuts and bolts, sort of the things that we will do. And the truth is, when I think about our mission to Panama, it's kind of like we're going to Golden Corral, right? A little bit of this, a little bit of that, kind of buffet-style mission trip, right? We'll be doing lots and lots of different things. That's kind of what Katie explained to you. But my purpose this morning is to show you the why of missions. I want you to know why, as a church, we believe missions. So I've entitled this sermon, A Theology of Missions. But before I tell you why, let me define the mission of the church before we get into a theology of missions. And then after I do that, what I'll do is I'll kind of break that down into bite-sized pieces to make it simple. So here's the big definition of what the mission of the church is, okay? The mission of the church is to display the glory of God. Okay, that's Ephesians 3, 8 through 11. By declaring the gospel to all peoples. That's Matthew 28, 18 through 20. By gathering churches in every place, kind of like what we're doing here. Romans 15, 7 through 13. And filling them with disciples who obey God and protect the purity of the gospel. 1 Timothy 1, 3 through 4 and 3:15. Who will praise him forever for his grace? Revelation 7, 9 through 10. Now, if you want all of that, I'll give you that at the end. After the service, I can kind of give you those scripture references. But I want you to notice something about my definition of the mission of the church. The mission of the church is not education or social action. The mission of the church is not mercy ministries like a soup kitchen or political involvement. The mission of the church is not medical ministries or cultural engagement. In a few weeks, we're going to have a man here, a pastor by the name of Micah Muir. And he's going to talk to us about adoption and foster care ministry. Can I tell you, as good of a ministry as that is not the mission of the church. Those pursuits, all of them, are good and healthy for individual Christians to pursue out of a calling, a personal calling from God. But that is not the mission God has given to the corporate local body, like our mission at First Baptist Church. Now, that doesn't mean we're not involved in some of those ministry areas. For instance, as a corporate church, we're involved in a partnership with Interfaith Ministries. We're involved with the center, which is a pregnancy help center in Wichita Falls. We're involved with Faith Refuge. And there's other ministries that we're also involved in. But here's what you need to know. Those things are not primary. Well, let me tease that out. If here at First, we don't have a soup kitchen or a clothes closet or an organized support group for public education reform, guess what? We can still fulfill the mission God has given us as a church. Okay? We can. But if here at First Baptist we don't share the gospel with the goal of assimilating new believers into our local body, we cannot fulfill the mission God has given to us. Do you see the difference? One is primary, one is ultimate and necessary, make disciples. And the other is kind of like a congregational freedom that we have. It's a liberty that can change from season to season in the church. See, the mission of the church is corporate, is about God's glory, his gospel. Think about all the passages we've read this morning about his glory going to the nations, the songs we've sung about Christ's blood spilled for us, the verses we've read about Christ, God reconciling us to himself. Let me give you the bite-sized definition of the mission of the church. Number one, it's to display the glory of God. We display God's glory in our holiness and our love for each other. That people should come into our local congregation and see a holiness, a distinctness, a set apartness in our character, and they should see a love. We display him corporately. We declare the good news of Jesus to the nations, to other people, with a goal of people coming into the church, new believers joining the body. That's one of the reasons we're so excited about Panama, because we get to work with the missionaries there who specifically work with local Panamanian Baptist churches, right? Who are on the ground doing ministry in their culture, in their setting, and we get to work alongside them to support their work in Panama. Thirdly, the mission of the church is to be a people who obey God and protect the purity of the gospel. Man, if you read the pastoral letters, you read the New Testament over and over and over again, here's what you're going to see. You're going to see the importance of the church being a buttress for truth, right? A pillar for the truth. We don't want a distorted gospel, so we must protect it. And then finally, we're a people who come together knowing that we will praise God forever. That's the mission of the church. Now that you know that, let me tell you about a theology of missions, or let me give you a theology of missions. And so we're going to begin at the foundation, I believe, for missions, and that is missions is for God's praise. Missions is for God's praise. In Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, God creates mankind. And what he says is this, he made man in the image. Everybody say image. Image. He made man in the image of God. Now, if I were to walk into your home, I wonder, if I looked at your walls, I wonder if I could see an image of you in your house. My bet is there's images of you on your walls. Maybe you're really fancy and you have a marble sculpture of yourself in the library. I hope you don't. That would be weird. We're kind of past that day, at least here in American culture. Mostly probably just pictures. But why do we put pictures of ourselves and our families up on the wall? Well, we want to remind ourselves of ourselves. Our family want to see us. But we also want to invite people into our home. We want to be a host, a good host. And when they come into our home, we want them to see pictures of us so they know what we're like, so they know what we love and what we do. So follow me here. Genesis 1 teaches we are made in the image of God in order that we would, guess what, image God or reflect who God is to each other and to the world. Just like the picture that's on your desk or on your wall of that 12-point buck you have sitting there to show the world that you have dominion and rule over creation, that you're a man, right? Just like that picture tells people about you, we, people, mankind, in like manner have been made in the image of God to make him known, to show him off, to bring him glory, to bring him praise. Now, God created mankind in general to image him, to show him off. But I want you to think about the Old Testament, and I want you to think about Israel, the people of Israel, specifically, okay? Israel, we find, was made or were chosen to be a people for God's praise. In Isaiah 43, verses 6 through 7, this is what we read. The prophet said, I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. God chose in Genesis 12, Abram, a pagan. He chose Abram, who he later called Abraham, to bless him and to make his descendants into a set-apart nation for his glory, to the praise of his great name. Mankind was formed for the praise of God's name. Israel was chosen for the praise of God's name. But what about missions? How is missions for God's praise? I'm glad you asked. It's a good question. Ephesians chapter 1, if you have your Bible, I'd invite you to turn there with me. In Ephesians chapter 1, Paul writes of the blessings of being in Christ. The blessings we receive for being children of God, not just children of God, but children of God who've believed on Christ, who have been saved. And what he does is he highlights God's work in our salvation, what God does in our salvation. And I want you to pay attention to the reason or the purpose we receive all of these blessings. I want you to ask yourself as I read, why did God do all these things? Okay, so let's look at Ephesians 1, chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. It says this, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So praise to his name. He is the one who is to be blessed. Why? Look at the verse 3. He has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Verse 4. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Okay, so why did he choose us before the foundation of the world? That we should be holy and blameless. We're going to be distinct before him. In love, verse 5, he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. Now here's where we see the why. Here's where we see the reason for all these spiritual blessings. Verse 6, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he blessed us in the beloved. So God's work of salvation, specifically what he talks about here is election and predestination to adoption. Do you see where they end? Do you see the goal of his choosing us? Do you see the goal of his predestining us to adoption? Do you see the goal of him redeeming us in his son, Jesus Christ? Verse 6, to the praise of his glorious grace. Now I want you to look back at verse 4. In verse 4, we get a time stamp on why or when God does this. Verse 4, it says, even as he chose us in him, when? Before the foundation of the world. That's important because from the very beginning, God's mind was, I will be praised. I will be praised. In missions, I will be praised. In salvation, I will be praised. When my name goes forth, I will be praised. Now here's the deal. I don't have time this morning to defend God's heart on going public with how great he is and how good he is and his seeking to be praised. But if you're wondering why God would seem so focused on his own glory, I would encourage you to hop on YouTube and to search down our church website page, FBCIP, First Baptist Church, Iowa Park, FBCIP, and track down my sermon I preached a couple of years ago called Radical Joy in Christ, because I spend about 20 minutes demonstrating why God is so good to show off his character and to show off himself. Because suffice it to say, in salvation, if God didn't show himself as great, if he didn't put his name out there for us to see, then we wouldn't know Jesus. Then you wouldn't know Jesus, and you wouldn't have salvation. And so it's a good thing for us. So in salvation, to Jew and Gentile, Texan and Panamanian, God will be praised. That's the foundation of missions, to his glory. Missions is first and foremost for the praise of God. But secondly, missions is by Christ's authority. It's by his authority. I believe the most explicit verse in the Bible on an aspect of the mission of the church is found in Matthew 28. We know it as the Great Commission. The Great Commission. So in Matthew 28, 18 through 20, this is what we read. It says, Jesus came to them. This is after his death, burial, and resurrection. Okay? He's about to ascend. And he comes to them and he says this, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Right? We just participated in that twice. Teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with, this is the great promise, I am with you always to the end of the age. See, the call to make disciples is, it's the warp and woof of missions, and it's planted in the authority of Christ. All right, go back to 16. And some of you, if you're, you know, past 60, maybe go back to 12. When you first got your driver's license, right? Go back to that moment. You got your driver's license, or maybe even before, if your parents used to let you drive at just any time. And that first time, you didn't have a vehicle at this point, but that first time, that Saturday morning, your dad looks at you and he's like, hey, son, we need some groceries for lunch. And he tosses you the keys and you're like, really? Like, is this happening right here? And he's like, son, take my truck, go to the grocery store. I give you permission. We need these groceries. And you're like, this is really happening. And so you walk out to the truck, under your father's authority with permission, and you go to the grocery. It's a great feeling. I remember that. It was an awesome feeling. And in an infinitely greater way, unimaginably greater way, Christ has given us, by his authority, the keys to mission, the task of missions. It's the means, church, that God uses to accomplish his salvation purposes in the world. So we've been given his authority. And here's the truth. By his authority, we will not fail. God's mission will be a success. In fact, the Bible tells us so. In John chapter 10, Jesus is believed to be at the Feast of Tabernacles. And here's what he says in John 10, 14 through 16. He says this, "I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me." So he's talking about intimacy with believers. I have this intimacy. I know them, they know me. "I am the good shepherd," he says. In verse 15, he goes on and says, "Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father." Now pause. Now the intimacy is even greater. "I know my sheep, I know my people, just like the Father knows me, and I know the Father." That is incredible, and we don't even get that. Continuing, he says, "And I lay down my life for the sheep." Verse 16. "And I have other sheep that are not of this fold." Now pause. This is now he's saying, okay, I'm speaking to the Jews here, but there are people outside the Jewish nation that are my sheep, right? So there are Gentiles. Raise your hand. Well, let's not do that. Never mind. I thought better of it. Anyways, if you're not a Jew and you're a Gentile, Jesus is literally talking about you here. And he says this. "I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also." And notice how determined and how it's completely certain. "I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd." Look, church, Jesus is going to accomplish his mission. He has other sheep, and he will track them down. He will accomplish the mission. He has the authority of the Father. When Jesus spoke Matthew 28, 18 through 20, when he spoke the Great Commission, he had defeated the grave. Sin had no claim on him. It was utterly impossible for sin to destroy his plan. He would bring his sheep into the fold. And we serve under the authority of Christ, the authority of a risen and victorious Savior, so we make disciples. Missions is for God's praise by Christ's authority. And thirdly, missions is to the nations. I mean, that's literally what Matthew 28 says. In verse 19, it says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." We cannot be faithful in missions. That the mission Christ has given us as a local congregation, as First Baptist Church, we cannot be faithful if we have no concern for the nations. We must pray to the Lord of harvest, right? The harvest is ripe, but the workers are few. So we must pray that the Lord of the harvest would send workers into the field. We must pray for the lost. We must, as a people, give consistently of our finances and faithfully to God through our church. And then as a church, we must steward these monies toward global missions. And we try to do that. We try to give 10% to the cooperative program every month. But I believe that's not enough. We also must go. See, Jesus didn't give himself as a ransom for Iowa Park or the surrounding areas alone. He didn't give himself as a ransom for Texas or the United States alone. In 1 Timothy 2, 5 and 6, Paul tells Timothy, his younger protege, who he gave himself as a ransom for. In verse 5, it says, "For there is one God, and then there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus," verse 6, "who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time." Jesus was a ransom for all people, every tribe, every tongue, every nation. And one day, guess what? We're not going to sit in this sanctuary forever and worship the Lord. In fact, the Bible tells us there's a day coming where we're going to come around the throne, where all nations will come around the throne and we will praise God then. In fact, in Revelation 7, 9 through 10, this is what John said as he gets a vision into heaven. He says this, "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes, peoples, and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.'" The scope of God's redemption is global. It's to the nations. Like Jesus said in John 10, he has other sheep not of this fold, and he will bring them home. God's going to accomplish his mission. But here's the reality. Here's the problem we face today in 2019. As of March 1st, 2019, according to the International Mission Board, it reports that there are 7,086 people groups, numbering approximately 4,482,576,741 people who are considered unreached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now let me define unreached for you. Unreached means that these people groups and these places are among whom Christ is largely unknown, and the church is relatively insufficient to make Christ known in its broader population without help from the outside. They put a statistic on it, and this is what they say. Statistically, there is less than 2% of those populations reached with the gospel, considered Christian. So over 7,000 people groups, numbering 4.4 billion people, have less than a 2% population of Christians. These churches that exist there need outside help. Help from people like us who preach off iPads, right? And who have 13 Bibles in their home. To make matters worse, as of February 2019, there are approximately 310 people groups numbering over 500 people in each people group where there is absolutely no strategy of reaching them. There is no missionary organization currently breaking ground into their people group, which means they have, from all statistics, they have no access to the gospel. And here's the reality. If that's the case, and they have no access to the gospel, they don't know the name of Jesus, according to Romans chapter 1, God will still hold each of them accountable, because he has made himself plain in his creation. And they will be without excuse on the day of judgment, even if they've never heard the gospel. So we believe, yes and amen, that Jesus is going to bring his sheep in. He will finish the mission, but he's going to do it through his people. He's going to do it through ordinary people like Lindy Lamb and you, by being faithful. The church is God's means. The need is high. We must participate in global missions to the nations, because missions is for God's praise. It's by Christ's authority, and it's to the nations. And finally, missions is through the local church. Let me ask you this. Who did Christ give the Great Commission to? I want you to think about that. Who did he give the Great Commission to? Well, first, he gave it to his apostles or his disciples, who we would consider to be the founders and the leaders of the church that would be established through their ministry and multiplied by their testimony and the power of the working of the Holy Spirit. That's the whole book of Acts. And that's who he first gave them to. But more broadly, the Great Commission was to the church, to people who would gather together. The text in Matthew 28 is almost always applied individually. And I don't think that's wrong. You should be making disciples at your work. And you should be making disciples in your sphere of influence. Personally, you need to be doing that. I mean, it's a calling you have on your life. But in a more fundamental sense, let me say this. This Great Commission was given to the church. I mean, let's look back at verses 19 and 20. It says this, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Verse 20, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. See, the Great Commission isn't simply to evangelize the world. Because if the Great Commission was simply just to share the gospel of Jesus and leave, individual Christians on their own could do it. And they would do it well, and they could fulfill that mission. That's not what the Great Commission is. And we know it's for the church because it has an emphasis on two things: baptism and holistic discipleship. Okay? Local communities of believers, the church, is where we participate in baptism. So this morning we got to experience and be a part of a great baptism, a great celebration, where we formally testify that they are believers, that we say yes to your testimony, that we believe you, that we love you, that we're excited for you, and we're going to walk beside you. It's a formal way. So when you clapped and you said amen, what you were saying is, I trust you. I believe your profession, and I'm going to walk with you the rest of your life, or the rest of your days that you're here with us. That's what you were saying. That's something you can only do in the church. And then you think about teaching everything that Christ has commanded. Anyone in here just feel adequate to do that? Like if I could just have one person, and I could spend my whole life just teaching them the Bible, I got this. I won't lead them astray. Like, I know everything there is to know. Right? None of us do. And if you feel that way, you need to look in the mirror, right? You need to think harder about your understanding of the Bible. We need each other. The church needs each other because we say things and then someone goes, hey, Josh, that sounds wrong. So you need to check yourself, right? Think about what the Bible says, not what you think, Josh. And we need people doing that. So missions happens most fundamentally and importantly as it happens through the local church. So here's my encouragement to you. Don't go thinking that you can fulfill the mission of God that Christ has given to us himself without the local church. You may feel like the church holds you back, right? That the church is slow, it's big, it's clunky. It takes months or even years to make simple decisions. And you may feel that way. And here's the deal. I've been there. Where I've been in a place in my life where I thought, man, I can do the mission of God without the church. In fact, I would be sleeker and faster, and I could do it in more unique ways because the church is an organism, but it's also an organization of people. Here's my encouragement to you if you feel that way, if you feel like the church slows you down. My encouragement would be to link arms with those people who you believe slow you down. Extend the right hand of fellowship to them. Pray for their growth. Work patiently, if I can use the language of Ephesians 4, work patiently to do the work of ministry in their life and in the life of this church. If you think the local church slows you up, let me ask you this. Do you believe you have more wisdom than God? Because it's God himself who set up the local church as the vehicle he would use to reach the nations. With all our sinful blemishes, with all our immature squabbles, and man, I'm telling you, with our slow sanctification, God still uses the church to reach the nations. So don't disconnect from the local body because it slows you down. Because ultimately, it's going to undermine your growth in love. It's going to undermine your growth in holiness. And we won't get the benefits of you using your spiritual gifts in our life for our edification. There is 1,000 ways God sanctifies you through the life of the local church. And I know some of you may have some zeal for the Lord and you feel like, the church holds me back. But don't sideline yourself because that's immature. And it's short-sighted, and it's not the plan of God. Trying to accomplish the Great Commission, the mission of the church, without the church is like saying, I love football. I love team football, but I really like it most when I play it by myself. It's nonsensical, right? It doesn't make sense, and it's self-defeating. So why will we continue to participate in missions here? Well, because we want to see God's name praised. We want to walk in the authority of Christ, reaching the nations with the gospel through the local church, our church.